He and his younger brother Bobby were certainly all too keenly aware of the extent to which their country was in the grip of organized crime, because their own father, the patriarch Joseph P. Kennedy, had made his personal fortune from running illegal liquor during the days of Prohibition, activities which earned him the nickname Bootlegger Joe. Experienced people are aware that the tendency of each new generation to reject the ideas of the previous generation is an abiding characteristic in human affairs, and it is perfectly plain that with Jack and Bobby, it had the effect of making both men highly principled. Their own father had associated with crooks and gangsters, and it was quite clear from their style and their outlook that they had made a commitment to make up for the sins of their father by rejecting this sinister world of hoods and crooks and corrupt politicians, by being honest and decent. If you take a look at any group photo from the early days, it's clear these men are being determinedly clean-cut, with the accent heavily on the clean part. They knew their father's generation were dirty. It couldn't be more obvious that they were determined to be the opposite. The question was, how were they going to free themselves and their country from the entanglements of the crooked politicians and the psychopathic mafia dons, who together were controlling the whole of American life like some multi-legged fascist octopus? How they were going to pull this off was something they were discussing ad nauseam when, in the late 1950s, they found out their father was in big trouble. A contract had been taken out on Joe Kennedy's life by the Purple Gang, the Jewish mafia of New York, who had accused him of swindling them out of a fortune. Joe Kennedy was really scared, and he turned for help toward the one man in North America who he knew had the power to get the contract called off, Sam Giancana. Giancana had done business with Kennedy for years, so he agreed to help, but he wanted something for it. He was all too aware of Joe's political ambitions for his son and of JFK's outstanding good looks. He wanted assurances that if Jack one day made it to the White House, Joe Kennedy would see to it that the heat the two brothers had been trying to turn up on the mafia would be turned down. And, according to Chuck and Sam Giancana Jr., Joseph B. Kennedy, just to save his own skin, agreed.
Will you tell us anything about any of your operations, or you just giggle every time I ask you a question?
Declined to answer because I honestly believe my answer might tend to incriminate me.
I thought only little girls giggled, Mr. Giancana.
In this way, a very confused situation was created, because Sam Giancana, the very kind of mob boss whom the Kennedys had been fighting so hard through the McClellan Committee to put in jail, now thought that they should and would be grateful to him. It was this expectation and this misunderstanding which now led Giancana to try to draw the Kennedys more and more into his dark world, something which he appeared to be succeeding with in the way that first Peter Lawford and then Frank Sinatra established relationships with both men. Lawford married Kennedy's sister.
Everyone is voting for Jack.
Sinatra was putting together campaigning jingles, and it must have seemed to many insiders at the time that when Sam Giancana went around boasting that, as usual, he had everything under control, and that when Jack got to the White House, it was going to be a dream ticket for the mafia, that it must all be true. His boys appeared to be partying together. And those who were in the know were aware that JFK had at least some sort of relationship with Judith Campbell Exner, Sam Giancana's girlfriend. What we haven't known until now is that JFK was hoodwinking Giancana all along. The role that Judy Campbell played was mostly that of a go-between. What Kennedy was doing through her was giving Giancana FBI reports on mob bosses to make him think that law enforcement were not all that well informed about the mafia scams and their movements, nor even terribly interested. What Giancana did not know was that the FBI reports he was receiving were carefully selected and most definitely incomplete. Kennedy was not helping Giancana. He was not keeping him in the picture. What he was doing was pulling the wool over his eyes. For the first time in his life, Sam Giancana was perplexed, and he became more confused when there was a sudden freezing over of relations. JFK abruptly ended his relationship with Sinatra, and Judy Campbell suddenly found the White House were refusing her calls. Even more to this, Giancana's limitations were shown up in the way he completely failed to comprehend that Kennedy truly was decent and honest. He apparently had many conversations with Murray the Camel Humphreys around this time, in which both were reassuring each other that Kennedy's white knight lifestyle was just a political game to make him look good. Quite clearly, this cynical outlook was the product of living in their dark and corrupt world. They had never known an honest and decent man, because in the Mafia, there's no such thing. There is no record of what was said during the three meetings which JFK had with Giancana and his father at the Fontainebleau Hotel just prior to the 1960 general election. But it does now seem that in this most titanic battle of wits between the craftiest criminal in America and the most brilliant politician the world had ever seen, Kennedy had won. He had played the Mafia at their own game and played it better. Why did John F. Kennedy do this? Because he must have known just what a dangerous game he was playing. There certainly appears to be no doubt, now that we ourselves are aware of the all-pervading influence of organized crime in America at that time, that this brave and decent and honest man had realized that he could never get rid of the Mafia and their dirty fascist friends in politics, industry and banking without first enlisting their help. He had to trick them. And with this new understanding, we can now see, for the first time, with the correct perspective, the motives, characters, intrigues, and diverse political interests which were gathering against President Kennedy when he took the oath of office. Organized crime were fearful of JFK before he ascended to power, because the shrewdest amongst them were getting a sense that he had outfoxed and outmaneuvered the all-powerful Mafia bosses. But the big mistake researchers have made in the past has been to not understand that every American oligarch, the big oil men, the captains of industry, the merchant bankers, the intelligence chiefs, were all crooks and gangsters as well. The biggest crook in the land was the head of law enforcement, J. Edgar Hoover. This is what historians have failed to understand until now. When JFK appointed his 32-year-old kid brother to the post of Attorney General, these people collectively froze. It now fully hit home that JFK really was honest and decent. It hit home that he wanted to make his country as honest and decent as he was, and that he actually believed that with the help of his energetic and determined crime-busting brother, that he could do it. His attitude, of course, stood in marked contrast to the man whom Kennedy was saddled with as his running mate. Anyone who has any doubts about the moral rectitude of the average American politician of that time has only to look at the career of Lyndon Baines Johnson to see that, generally speaking, they were worse than the Mafia itself. From his involvement with the Box 13 scandal and through all of his dealings with his crooked Texan business associate, Billy Solestes, LBJ proved again and again that he was every bit as unscrupulous as any mob boss and willing to do absolutely anything for power. This was a man who'd had his own sister, Josepha, murdered by his personal hitman, a highly intelligent and psychopathic killer named Malcolm Wallace, who later shot dead the golf professional, John Douglas Kinzer. When this case came to court, it revealed to the American public how totally corrupt the justice system had become, because LBJ was able to get Wallace off with a 5-year suspended sentence. Found guilty of murder one, he walked free that very day. This was the sort of corruption which was running rife through the American political system when Fidel Castro overthrew the right-wing government of Fulgencio Batista in 1959. Few people are aware that by this advanced stage in their relationship, the CIA and the Mafia were together employing the Giancana tactic of supporting both sides in a war. For many years beforehand, they had been supporting Castro, and not just the Batista regime, as many think, by smuggling in both arms and mercenaries to aid the peasant farmers. One of these mercenaries, an Italian-American called Frank Fiorini, later came to play a pivotal role both in the assassination and subsequent cover-up under his assumed name, Frank Sturgis. Sturgis and Castro were photographed together many times during the Cuban Revolution. But after Castro enlisted the help of the Russian Soviets, Sturgis turned against him. Like many in the CIA Mafia network, he felt double-crossed when Castro closed the island's casinos and nationalized all Cuban business. He therefore joined forces with men like Bernard Barker, Batista's former secret police chief, and other Cuban expats who had fled en masse to Miami, Florida, and who now sat together on the American mainland as a very disgruntled and highly politicized splinter group. Of course, to the American Nazis, who had bankrolled Hitler, this was intolerable. It was a commercial disaster. Coca-Cola had made millions in easy profits using dirt-cheap Cuban sugar grown by dirt-poor Cuban peasants. They were now being told by an upstart third-world dictator that they would have to pay for sugar at the normal market rate. And the mafia were losing millions every single day from the loss of illegal gambling. America's Nazi shadow government therefore decided that someone was going to have to mould this loosely knit group of disgruntled anti-Castro Cubans into a crack invasion force to retake the island. Having put their heads together, Dulles and Harriman and Richard Bissell decided this would be an excellent job for Prescott's eldest son, George Herbert Walker Bush, a chance for him to prove himself, along with one of his Texas oil business associates, Jack Alston Crichton. Together, these two recruited and trained the Cubans for several terrorist groups known as Operation 40, Alpha 66, ZR Rifle, and Operation Mongoose. Renegade bands of merciless assassins who would kill Castro and who could later be counted on to eliminate any other third world leaders who dared to interfere with American commercial interests. It was this diverse and unsavory stream of political intrigue which produced President Kennedy's first great political crisis, the Bay of Pigs, in 1962. By this time, JFK was well aware that the CIA was something much more like a private firm or a family. He wasn't surprised when they invaded Cuba without his permission, because he knew they were totally out of control. His antipathy led him to cancel the promised air support, and inevitably the invasion failed. The anti-Castro Cubans were mostly captured, and Kennedy then tried to add insult to injury by ordering J. Edgar Hoover's FBI to close down the camps where the Cubans were trained. He even allowed Khrushchev, the Soviet leader, to inspect the camps to see they were closed, so this could never happen again. Having only just escaped with his life at the Bay of Pigs, it was pretty clear that Frank Sturgis was more than a little annoyed.
He was scared because Khrushchev says, don't do this or we're going to do that. You know, so he didn't do it, and he deserted the Bay of Pigs. I was involved in the Bay of Pigs. You got a lot of people, friends of mine, that were killed in the Bay of Pigs. And I resent that. Don't play political games with me. I'm a military man. I'm a soldier. I go fight. But damn it, if I risk my ass out there and I'm getting shot at, I don't want some stupid-ass politician to go ahead and make deals behind my back where my people or maybe myself are going to get killed. I don't like that.
This, then, is how the stage was set for the Kennedy assassination. And when one remembers the colossal number of ruthless and hideously brutal men who had created this situation, it's perhaps a little ironic that a peripheral figure in the cast of characters who actually put the plot together was an attractive young woman. 19-year-old Marita Lorenz's love affair with Fidel Castro and her subsequent recruitment as a CIA assassin by Frank Sturgis to kill him is a very well-known story because it was made into a feature film. In spite of her failure to kill the Cuban leader, Lorenz continued to associate with the assassination squads trained by the CIA, and it was largely her testimony in the Spotlight magazine trial after a skillful cross-examination by Mark Lane, which gave us a window through which we can now see who really participated in the Kennedy assassination and who was really behind it all. First of all, after the Bay of Pigs invasion, Kennedy had fired Alan Dulles, Richard Bissell, and General Charles Cable for essentially using the CIA as their personal hitmen after he found out that Robert Mayhew had sought Sam Giancana's permission to talk to his underboss, Johnny Roselli, about the possibility of a hit on Fidel Castro. Here you have a government agency funded by the American taxpayer associating with the very organized crime racketeers JFK was trying to put in jail for the purpose of carrying out political murders. The president was incensed. Historians have never been surprised that he vowed to smash the CIA into 1,000 pieces. It hardly takes a genius to see why the CIA wanted to kill him. What is more, Jack Alston Crichton and the lifelong friends of Alan Dulles, the Bush family, had just recently purchased exclusive access to 15 million acres of Cuba, almost half the entire island, in order to drill for oil. When he came to power, Castro reduced this to a mere 20,000 acres, a colossal investment which now failed and which led to Crichton CVOVT Oil Exploration Company being delisted from the stock exchange at a loss of $30 million. Crichton and George Bush's friends, the Texas oil billionaires Clint Murchison and Haroldson Lafayette Hunt, also knew that Kennedy wanted to end their most vital tax break, the oil depletion allowance. And their bosom buddy, Vice President Lyndon Johnson, was standing at this time with one foot in jail and the other on a banana skin due to his involvement in the corruption scandal now breaking around his favorite assistant, Bobby Baker. LBJ knew his life was finished if Kennedy lived, and he would become president himself if Kennedy died. So his involvement in the plot is hardly difficult to understand. And even more to this, the heads both of the US military and the military-industrial complex which supplied them, exactly the same Nazis who had supported Hitler in World War II, were fully aware that Kennedy wanted to pull out of Vietnam in a move which would have eventually cost them billions in lost weapons sales. This circle of thugs and pirates was completed by LBJ's next-door neighbor, J. Edgar Hoover, who had himself invested millions in Clint Murchison's oil business, just like his mafia associate, Vito Genovese. Stepping back to look upon this rogues gallery, it really is remarkable how Kennedy had managed to make an enemy out of every single dirty hood, every corrupt politician, and every single Nazi businessman living in the country at that time. It is highly misleading even to see these groups as separate, because the truth is that they were all brutal fascists who saw nothing wrong in killing to get their own way. The question now was, how were they going to get him? Because we must never forget that generals, admirals, mafia dons, intelligence chiefs, corrupt politicians and oil billionaires are only people. None of them wanted to go to the electric chair for conspiracy to murder the president. They knew that they had to put together a plan which could not fail to both kill Kennedy and then cover up afterwards the fact that they did it. They knew that in men like Frank Sturgis, his Cuban assassination squads, and the mafia hitmen working with the CIA, they had a huge pool of killers to choose from who were ready, able, and willing to do the deed. All the same, how could they possibly get to Kennedy? Because they knew that, at least in Washington, all American presidents are extremely well protected by the Secret Service. The most important first step was to engage the age-old mafia tactic of finding a patsy. To this end, they turned to George Demorenschild, a very sophisticated exiled Russian count and CIA agent, who was close friends in the oil business with George Bush and the Texas oil men. They were aware that they needed someone like Giuseppe Zangara, who appeared to be a low-life, discontented misfit. So they chose a low-level CIA operative who had been groomed precisely in order to appear to be a low-life, discontented misfit, Ender Lee Harvey Oswald, who was carefully handled by Demorenschild as he was placed like a chess piece in the Texas School Book Depository. With the patsy selected, the combined heads of the American Nazis now sat down together to discuss their problem. How do you kill a man riding in an open car on a public street in front of hordes of people without being seen? And then, how do you cover up forever afterwards the fact that this was a conspiracy and not the work of a lone nut? The plotters were keenly aware that it was the second question which posed the biggest problem. The professional military men like Colonel Ed Lansdale and Admiral George Berkeley, Kennedy's personal physician, were well aware that there are any number of ways to hide or disguise a sniper: behind trees, inside other vehicles, behind windows in office buildings. But this was a plot which had to have an absolute guarantee of success. If a squad of riflemen were all to fire at their target at the same time, this would certainly guarantee the man's death. But the subsequent police investigation would instantly realize more than one shooter was involved. A team of gunmen all firing together might actually blow Kennedy's head clean off, A single sniper couldn't do that. So what were they to do? It was during these deliberations that a macabre thought first registered. They would have to control the body after the shooting in order to make sure that all physical evidence available to police forensic scientists conformed to the scenario of a single assassin. And just how in the hell were they going to do that? By way of preparing the ground, Sam Giancana now ordered Richard Nixon's political associate Jack Ruby to keep Oswald snug under his wing, and then to set about hiring the best local rifleman, preferred candidates being men like his close friend Charles Void Harrelson, the father of Hollywood actor Woody Harrelson, who had proven his hitman credentials by shooting dead dozens of men for money. He then turned to his mafia associates Carlos Marcello and Santos Traficante to supply the best gunmen from their cities, while he himself instructed the well-known underboss Tony Accardo to give the Chicago end of the contract to Giancana's favourite and most trusted hoodlums, Charles Nicoletti and Milwaukee Phil Aldericio. This pair had to be flown in 1,500 miles to the ranch of mafiahood Peter LaCavale, and then driven the remaining 600 miles to Dallas. It had been agreed with Giancana's and Genovese's oil business partners, H.L. Hunt and Clint Murchison, that every gunman would be paid $50,000 for the hit, and that the oil men would stump up the cash, so there was no way of tracing it back to either the mob or the CIA. For their part, Jack Crichton and George Bush were trying to lay the groundwork at the street level with the mayor, Earl Cable, the brother of CIA chief Charles Cable, whom Kennedy had fired. Both the Cable brothers were crucially important in the development of the fine details of the plot, because they agreed to allow Crichton and his associates, George Lumpkin, the Dallas police chief, Lieutenant Colonel George Whitmire, and Harry Weatherford, to make use of their 488th Military Intelligence Detachment, a privately funded part-time intelligence force which had amongst its ranks many members of the John Birch Society, the Ku Klux Klan, and around half of all the serving police officers in Dallas. The plotters realized this was a masterstroke, because it meant they could control the streets and the crime scene, but they also realized that when the shooting occurred, the response of at least half the police on duty would appear to be completely genuine. And yet, for all this intricate planning, involving, as Sam Giancana later admitted, dozens of men, the American Nazis were aware they still had a problem. Getting the snipers into position and coordinating their fire by radio was not too difficult. It's something the military do every day. But this problem of blowing the man's head clean off had another side to it. Supposing, as can happen, all the snipers missed, how could they possibly legislate for this contingency? You see, being a professional sniper is a lot like being a professional golfer. Everyone knows that, generally speaking, a golf pro on a par 3 will hit the green. But even the world's best occasionally miss by a wide margin, and the same can happen to any rifleman. We can be quite certain that the guiding brains of the American Nazis, Alan Dulles and David Attlee Phillips, in order to cover this eventuality, must have at least considered having one assassin run up to the limousine to attempt a point-blank range mafia-style shooting should the others miss. But then another problem appeared, supposing their assassin couldn't run quick enough to jump on a speeding car. Little by little, the realization hit home. The plot could even wind up looking silly and themselves ridiculous. There was only one answer. They would have to control the president's protection, the Secret Service. Marita Lorenz testified under oath that in late November of 1963, she drove from Miami to Dallas, Texas with Frank Sturgis, followed by a backup car which contained a stash of weapons. Traveling along with them were Jerry Patrick Hemming, an American mercenary like Sturgis.
Were you ever offered money to assassinate President Kennedy?
Directly. On numerous occasions.
Two Cuban brothers, Ignacio and Guillermo Novo Sampol, a Cuban pilot called Pedro Diaz Lance, and his friend, Orlando Bosch. At first, Maritri assumed this was to be just another arms smuggling engagement, just like many others she'd been on with Sturgis before. However, when they reached their Dallas motel, they were visited by someone Maritri had met many times before, CIA agent E. Howard Hunt, who stayed almost an hour and paid Sturgis with cash stuffed in a very large envelope. This was the evening of November 21st, 1963, and Maritri began to get worried. She knew that President Kennedy was visiting Dallas the next day. Becoming concerned, she pressed Sturgis as to the real purpose of the visit, and when he told her that for this one time it had to be confidential, she decided she wanted out. Maritri had no way of knowing that a great number of other people had made similar journeys that day. CIA pilot Tosh Plumley flew several assassins into Dallas Love Field without even being told who they were. From all over the country, radio operators, riflemen, drivers, false ID suppliers like Chauncey Holt and Bernard Barker, and getaway pilots like David Ferry, converged on the city. Whilst at the home of oil man Clint Murchison, a group of his Nazi friends were congregating to celebrate Kennedy's imminent demise. Due to the testimony of LBJ's mistress, Madeline Duncan Brown, the mother of his illegitimate son, we now know that amongst these guests were J. Edgar Hoover and his homosexual lover, Clyde Tolson, who stood to lose the millions they'd invested in their host's oil business if Kennedy lived. Hoover also knew Kennedy wanted to replace him as head of the FBI. The two Brown brothers of Brown Brothers Harriman, who along with Cliff Carter, John Connolly, and Senator Joseph Yarborough, stood to lose millions from lost defense contracts because they knew JFK wanted to end the Vietnam War. Also present were Joseph Sevilla, head of the mafia in Dallas, and the mayor of Dallas, Earl Cable, the CIA men who knew the president was serious about smashing the Central Intelligence Agency because he'd already fired Cable's brother, Charles. Having a drink with them was Chase Manhattan bank chief John McCloy, a confirmed Nazi who had shared a box with Hitler at the 1936 Berlin Olympic Games, and mafia chieftain Carlos Marcello, who felt nicely at home rubbing shoulders with Sam Giancana's representatives, Jack Ruby, Richard Nixon, and Haroldson Lafayette Hunt. The media were represented by Eamon G. Carter, and the only one who might have felt a little out of place as he awaited his boss was the world-class marksman and serial killer Malcolm Wallace. Late in the evening, Lyndon Baines Johnson finally turned up and briefly went into the party. When he came out to greet Madeline Brown, she said he was euphoric.
Let's go back to the night before. When Johnson came out of the meeting, what did he say to you?
He was so angry. He had a violent temper when he was upset.
Well, let's use the exact words that he said to you. What did he say to you?
He grabbed me by the arm, and he had this deep voice, and he said, "After tomorrow, those SOBs will never embarrass me again. That's no threat. That's a promise."
Johnson had clearly been told by the people in that room that everything was ready. The next morning, the president landed at Love Field and was led to his car by Governor John Connolly. As he is driven away, it is immediately apparent that something is wrong, as Secret Service agent Henry J. Rickber tries to take up his proper position on the president's limousine, holding on to these handles provided for the purpose, and is ordered to stand down by Emery Roberts. Let's just look at Rickber's reaction again. He is quite clearly disgusted. Why aren't they letting him do his job? And as the car glides into Dallas, we can now see how the removal of his Secret Service protection has opened the president up to a field of fire from almost any direction. It's plain from these pictures that as the motorcade moved on into Dallas, the Secret Service, meant to protect the president, remained crowded together on the vehicle behind. While traveling in the pilot car some 400 yards ahead, three men are smiling, as they see everything is going to plan. Crichton, Lumpkin, and Whitmire have used their influence to remove the military protection which should have been amongst the crowd. And whilst the people lining the parade route are 10 deep in places, Lumpkin has seen to it that the police have let almost no one into the would-be crime scene. Pausing at the corner of Houston and Elm, Lumpkin is seen exchanging reassurances with one of his men. Yes, he tells him, the hit is on. Glancing discreetly upwards, he sees Weatherford and the best Cuban sniper, Eladio Del Valle, preparing to fire. The signal is passed to the other snipers to get into position. Having been let into the Daltex building by Oil Baron Haroldson Hunt, Eugene Hale Brading unlocks the second floor broom closet. A client of New Orleans lawyer G. Ray Gill, who also represents mafia boss Carlos Marcello, Brading has a getaway pilot waiting, whom Gill employs as a private detective, David Ferry. He opens the window, and as Charles Nicoletti loads his rifle, Richard Kane listens to his radio. Car coming. Get ready. Closing the door, Milwaukee Phil Aldericio guards the corridor with two Cubans, Rolando Mesferrer and Rolando Otero. This basic pattern was established all over the plaza. A sniper next to a radio man, alongside a second marksman who could take over should the first want to back out at the last moment. Each team was then guarded by more assassins, mainly Cubans, who made sure no one interfered with each group. It all sounds quite professional, and the truth is, it was. Sam Giancana's spy in the Chicago police force, Richard Kane, was an electronics and wiretapping expert who spoke five languages. Up on the grassy knoll, with his childhood friend Charles Harrison, stood the diminutive Charles Frederick Rogers, a nuclear physicist who worked in seismology for Shell Oil. He was also friends with David Ferry and the Civil Air Patrol. Up in the Texas School Book Depository, LBJ's psychotic hitman Malcolm Wallace held a PhD and taught at the University of Texas. The Texas oilmen, mafia dons, merchant bankers and military industrialists had assembled the all-time dream team of professional killers. They were there to make absolutely certain their king died, and the two men who in later years would steal his crown, Richard Milhouse Nixon and George Herbert Walker Bush, smiled from the sidewalk as they exchanged winks with Jack Crichton. There was no way Kennedy could escape now, and they knew it. Arranging his sniper's nest at the other end of the sixth floor, Sturgis was the first to be spotted by Arnold Rowland.
I just looking around and we noticed a man up in the window, and I remarked to my wife, tried to point him out, and remarked that he must be a security guard, Secret Service agent.
So the window then that you're referring to is on the opposite end of the building from where the main entrance to the building is.
Yes, it is on the other side of the building. And he had a rifle. It looked like a high-powered rifle because it had a scope which looked in relation to the size of the rifle to be a big scope.
A moment later, 15-year-old Amos Ewins caught sight of one of the Sturgis-trained Cubans, Ignacio Novo Sampol. Even more significantly, Richard Randolph Carr, a steel construction worker who was looking for a job in the new Dallas courthouse, which was then under construction, stared out from his seventh-floor vantage point and saw Malcolm Wallace taking position to fire. Testifying at the trial of Clay Shaw, he gave a minutely detailed description of a very heavy-set man in a sports jacket who wore large-framed glasses. He could see the man so clearly, he even said his eyeglasses had large ear pieces. America, the home of the brave and the land of the free, was about to discover that it wasn't what it thought it was. As the president's car made the turn onto Houston, government agents, who had sworn an oath to uphold their country's democratic principles, waited alongside mafia killers to murder their own commander-in-chief. One of the men they were working for, Sam Giancana, said this proved that in reality there was no such thing as white hats and black hats. That notion, he said, was just a sham for saps to cling to.
The one thing I recognized was there are no black hats and there are no white hats. They all conduct themselves the exact same. And very good evidence of that is that the CIA would hire two so-called mafia men, Sam Giancana and John Roselli, to assassinate Fidel Castro. If there's such a difference, you're not supposed to have anything to do with each other. But in essence, the remark is really they're all in bed together. They all do business together.
It was now that Abraham Zapruder pressed the trigger on his 8mm cine camera. Ever since that moment, the world has accepted that what he recorded was the definitive account of what really happened. What people must appreciate is that what they have just seen is not at all what really happened. Had you actually been there on the day, this is what you would have seen. Doesn't that look a great deal more suspicious? So just exactly what did happen during the 10 seconds Zapruder was filming? To begin with, Dulles, Lansdale and Attlee Phillips had tried to get over the problem of volley fire, blowing the president's head clean off, by firing in four stages. Stage one was meant to be a single shot by Charles Nicoletti into the back of Kennedy's head from the Daltex building some 40 yards behind. Had he succeeded, the plotters would have had the single assassin with one bullet story they wanted. But in his excitement, the mafia assassin squeezed the trigger too soon. His bullet ricocheted off the hard chrome sill of the limo's back seat and struck the curb beneath the overpass, sending up a sharp piece of concrete which scratched James Tague's face. Watch again. We clearly see how this little girl stops running and her gaze looks directly at where the shot originated and not up at the sixth floor of the depository. It was now that Umbrella Man took over. Standing right at the curbside, it was his job, should the first shot miss, to give a clear visual signal. Target is not injured. The intelligence chiefs knew that if this situation occurred, Kennedy would now be moving rapidly away from the first sniper. They knew the only way to make sure of getting him was to fusillade the car. So a moment later, two rifles tried to fire from directly in front at exactly the same time to deceive witnesses into thinking there was only one shot.
You said you'd killed President Kennedy.
At the same time, I said I had killed the judge. I said I had killed Kennedy. Well, do you believe Lee Harvey Oswald killed President Kennedy? We'll get back to that. Alone, without any aid from a rogue agency of the U.S. government, or at least a portion of that agency. I believe you're very naive if you do.
Harrelson's bullet hit JFK in the throat, and another gunman, hiding in a culvert 50 yards away, up in the embankment of the overpass, made the hole in the windscreen, which was later seen by Dr. Evalier Glanges.
The presidential limousine was there. Had been staying there for some time, just watching the back of the emergency room. Talked to my friend next to me and said, look, there's a bullet hole in the windshield, and pointed it out to them. But it was very clear, it was a through and through bullet hole through the windshield of the car, from the front to the back.
As Kennedy emerges from behind the road sign, his distress is clear, while Governor Connolly remains composed. This single frame of the Zapruder film makes nonsense of the single bullet theory, because it's quite clear both men have not been struck at the same time. Kennedy has now passed through two layers of fire, and has not been hit in the head. To cover this eventuality, the assassins were given a simple instruction. Fusillade the car with everything. So that in the next few moments, the five remaining riflemen fired, causing the Secret Service agent riding in the front passenger seat, Roy Kellerman, to report a feeling like a jet sonic boom as the hail of bullets whistled into the car. It is now more than 3 seconds after Kennedy is hit in the throat that Frank Sturgis misses his target altogether and blows out 5 inches of Governor Connolly's ribs, compressing his lungs and puffing his cheeks. With a bullet, which quite clearly struck at far too steep an angle to come from the other end of the depository. In almost the same instant, Eladio Del Valle hit the governor in the wrist, Weatherford fired into his thigh, and Nicoletti's second shot hit the chrome frame of the window. A moment later, the best marksman, Malcolm Wallace, shot Kennedy in his upper back, the bullet strike witnessed and recorded by all the Secret Service men in the following car. Jackie Kennedy starts looking concerned, and yet even now there are no obvious signs that her husband, held upright by his back brace, has been shot twice. The assassins have so far failed to hit him in the head, and it is now that they play the ace up their sleeve. Here we can finally answer the riddle of where on an empty street you can hide a man with a rifle, and how he can manage to shoot a man speeding past him in a limousine. The answer is that he can't, and that is why the driver, William Greer, looked around twice to see whether Kennedy had been hit in the head, and when he saw he hadn't, as dozens of witnesses, including police officers, confirmed, he stopped the car completely.
His orders was to slow down where the rest of the guys...
This is Greer, the driver of the presidential limousine.
Yeah, presidential limousine, yeah. Slow down almost to stop.
It is now that most people have been led to believe that Kennedy was shot in the head by Charles Void Harrelson, the sniper standing on the grassy knoll. This is not true. Because if we look at the angle of elevation of a shot from that area, it's obvious that a shot originating from above and right would have pushed Kennedy's head down and left. Whereas it's quite clear that his head is knocked upwards and to the left by the impact. So where did that bullet come from? Incredibly, the answer has lain hidden in the most well-known and iconic image from the assassination of the motorcycle policeman heaving his bike onto its stand. Look now as we freeze frame him here. This is the moment when the whole world was looking up the hill toward the man who had fired from the grassy knoll, but that is not where the police officer is looking. He is looking down into the storm drain, because that is where that shot at a stationary car came from. The shot which all of the well-known assassination witnesses described as coming from behind the picket fence missed completely and ripped up the grass at Jean Hill's feet. She did not even notice, but we know this is true because the FBI told her so. So who were the men who fired unseen from the storm drains on Elm Street? One thing we know is that they were very young and had to be brought into the conspiracy because they had to crawl into a filthy, smelly sewer, something which the older, experienced mafia assassins would never have dreamed of doing. They were basically two kids looking for excitement. The first was Curtis Laverne Crayford, also known as Larry Crayford. Formerly CIA, he had worked for Ruby at the Carousel Club, and Ruby had told everyone his name was Lee Harvey Oswald until Lee Harvey Oswald walked in. But while above ground, the world was taking pictures and running and screaming and trying to figure out what had happened, the other young man was stumbling along 400 yards of a reeking, fetid Dallas sewer pipe to emerge from this culvert. And he was not Lee Harvey Oswald or Roscoe White or J.D. Tippett, nor even a Cuban or Russian communist. His name was Jack Allen Lawrence. And we know that after stumbling up this bank, he turned up 15 minutes later at the Lincoln Mercury car showroom, where he'd obtained a job with false references. Pale, sweating, and on a hot sunny day in Dallas, covered in mud. Telling his co-workers, Albert Bogard and Robert Tater, he had been ill that morning, he stumbled into the men's room and threw up, while they, feeling his behaviour was suspicious, called the police, who made a record of the entire incident. Back at the plaza, the guilt of the radio men coordinating the gunfire can be seen from their behaviour. These two, Orlando Bosch and the Umbrella Man, have a seat, while everyone else runs around them. Bosch makes a report that the hit was successful, then casually walks away. Just like the chief radio coordinator, Jim Hicks, with the radios clearly visible in their back pockets. A few yards away, the CIA's cleanup squad have begun working to remove all evidence useful to a forensic team. Deputy Sheriff Buddy Walters is here seen finding the bullet which struck in the grass near the manhole cover. He hands it on to one of the fake FBI men, who pockets it. While this is going on, Rogers, Harrelson, and E. Howard Hunt are discovered hiding in the boxcars of the train which they hoped would be their getaway vehicle, until it's prevented from moving by railway dispatcher and key witness Lee Bowers. They are photographed repeatedly as they are marched to the Dallas courthouse. And we can clearly see in this picture the radio receiver Hunt is wearing in his right ear, which is identical to the receivers worn by those Dallas police officers who were part of the plot. As they walk, they are overseen by Colonel Ed Lansdale, who secures their release and begins to give the press the cover story that this man is the major suspect and that acting alone he shot the president from behind. The truth, as we now know, is that 8 separate snipers firing 16 shots in 4 separate stages had tried to make certain of killing the president by hitting him in the head and had failed abysmally. The shooting on the day had been nothing to write home about. A third of all the shots had missed the car completely. Had it not been for the ruse of bribing the driver to brake at a point painted on the curbside, which is still visible, so that Jack Lawrence could shoot Kennedy in the head from just 15 feet away, the president might have survived. So now we must address the question, why does the Zapruder film not show this very obvious setup of the limousine stopping for the headshot? The answer, of course, is that it has been tampered with. In the 1960s, Hollywood special effects teams had developed techniques for masking off segments of film frames to disguise the true movement of figures within the picture. In the Zapruder film, frames have been removed in order to fake a continuous flowing motion, so that we don't see the very obvious setup which dozens of witnesses reported. If you look now at the top of the frame, the doctoring of the film becomes perfectly obvious in the way in which the figures are blurred and yet the shadows are sharp, which is impossible. This CIA tampering with the evidence becomes even clearer when the Zapruder film is run next to the Orville Nix film taken from the other side. It's easy to see from the way the motorcycles suddenly close on the limousine that it stops completely. And we can see that frames have also been removed from the next film by the way in which Agent Clint Hill appears to move sideways while running forwards before leaping on the car. As the mad dash to Parkland Hospital begins, the chief coordinator in the assassination plot, George Herbert Walker Bush, casually relaxes with hands in his pockets at the entrance of the school book depository. Now this is going to be one of those all too familiar Kennedy assassination moments in which people will say, well, yes, it could be him, but how can we be sure? Because we've seen this kind of thing before with Badgeman. However, a gentleman who I think must be a police detective has posted a YouTube video in which he utilizes the latest forensic techniques for identifying murder suspects by making a comparison between the photo taken in Dealey Plaza and one of George Bush in conversation with Richard Nixon during Watergate. This man points out that this person has exactly the same skull shape, exactly the same hairline, chin and nose as George Bush. He is also wearing the same type of suit, white shirt and exactly the same type of tie. He is exactly the same height, the same weight, is wearing clothing which matches down to his shoes, but most importantly, he has a characteristic mannerism of cocking his right wrist when he puts his hands in his pockets. We know from this declassified FBI memo that George Bush was in Dallas, staying at the Sheraton on November 22nd. So can there be any doubt about this person's identity? Surrounded by the corrupt policemen he was coordinating, Bush knew already that if an honest officer should happen to catch one of the assassins, it would, because of what Mark Lane rightly calls plausible deniability, make no difference. Because what would they find? Mafia hoods with prison records as long as their arms? Or contract killers like Charles Harrelson? They certainly wouldn't have found anyone who carried CIA credentials or anyone whose involvement with the government could be traced. But even while he smiled and chatted to his fellow killers, Bush was unaware that the plotters had just made their first big mistake. They knew that they had to forensically control the body from the moment the shots were fired, and the moment Kennedy entered Trauma Room 1, that control had to be relinquished. Although they had CIA agents placed in the emergency unit, these people were not aware of the throat wound, which could hardly be seen because it was so tiny. It was at this moment that all the Dallas doctors and nurses like Aubrey Bell made a mental note of this very obvious sign of a frontal entry shot. One of the Dallas medical team, Dr. Charles Crenshaw, a junior doctor at that time, vividly recalls what the first professionals in the Kennedy killing had to deal with.
The second wound was here in the throat, right above the necktie. It was a small opening, very small, 3 to 5 millimeters, about the size of your little finger. I looked at the wound again. I wanted to know and remember this the rest of my life. And the rest of my life, I will always know he was shot from the front.
And also described the portion missing from the rear of Kennedy's head after the impact of the frangible bullet, which hit him in the right temple.
The bullet struck about where and passed about where?
From here
right
through.
And taking out the...
The back or the occipital part. The back of your head. This was gone.
At approximately 1 o'clock Central Standard Time today here in Dallas. He died of a gunshot wound.
This information soon made its way to the media. And this is why at the very first press conference, Press Secretary Malcolm Kilduff correctly described the cause of death and direction of the shot. In order to find a means with which to contradict this evidence, the cover-up now began in earnest, with the summoning from the Restland funeral home of a CIA agent who was known for being the best in the business at reconstructive surgery on cadavers, John Melvin Liggett. This man was actually attending a funeral when he was told of the president's assassination and asked to go to Parkland by the coroner. What he didn't know as he drove away was that one of his clients in this macabre and gruesome story was at that moment still alive. When he was arrested years later by New York police detective Jim Rothstein, Frank Sturgis, on discovering that Rothstein was a Bay of Pigs veteran like himself, got into an old army buddy's conversation with him and said first of all that after the assassination he returned to the Miami safe house where he ridiculed Marita Lorenz for missing history. It was all perfectly safe, he told her. No cops, no newspaper investigation, everything was covered.
I asked Sturgis, Jesus Christ, Frank, did you shoot the president? Did you have something to do with that? He said, who gives a shit? Yeah, who's going to prove it? He said, we kill a lot of people. What the hell's the difference?
Sturgis then went on to say that Dallas police officer J.D. Tibbett was actually gunned down by the radio talk show host G. Gordon Liddy, who was at that time a CIA agent working with E. Howard Hunt. And here we must address a question which puzzled assassination researchers for years. Why did a Dallas policeman have to die within a few minutes of President Kennedy? What possible function could he have played in the overall plot as a corpse? One would think the authorities could have caught the fleeing patsy without any need to incriminate him any further. So why did the life of J.D. Tibbett also have to end on the 22nd of November, 1963? Where did he fit in? In only the last few years, a wonderful investigator called Robert D. Morningstar discovered one tiny little fact about Jefferson Davis Tibbett, which became the most important single piece in the completion of this puzzle. Because Officer Tibbett had a nickname. When he was at work, his fellow officers always used to call him JFK, because at 39 years of age, he looked exactly like him. In the only well-known picture of Tibbett, his Elvis haircut makes him appear very youthful. But having turned grey and having nearly turned 40, most people felt his resemblance to Kennedy was uncanny. What Tibbett never knew, as he drove past assassination witnesses Jack Tatum, Domingo Benavides and Aquila Clemens, was that he had been selected to play the role of the president in death. Researchers have always believed it couldn't be a coincidence that Tibbett was shot in the right temple, just like JFK, some 45 minutes earlier. They wondered why bullets had been removed from his body in the ambulance, and why, when he was pronounced dead on arrival at the Methodist Hospital, it was felt necessary to move his body to Parkland. With their concentration firmly fixed on the casket of the deceased president, the newsmen completely ignored the ambulance which spirited away the body of J.D. Tibbett, so that it could be loaded onto Air Force 2, where John Melvin Liggett was waiting. When Kennedy's casket arrived at Love Field a few minutes later, Clint Hill, the agent who jumped on the car, recalled that all the people aboard Air Force 1 were told they had to go forward to witness the swearing-in of Lyndon Baines Johnson. This, of course, was just a ruse to get Jackie Kennedy to leave her husband's body, and the moment she was out of the way, his cadaver was stolen and placed aboard Air Force 2 next to the cadaver of J.D. Tibbett. Many people have seen this famous picture in which LBJ is smiling at Congressman Albert Thomas a moment after becoming president, and he is winking back. We haven't known until now just how huge and terrible a secret he was sharing with Johnson, because at that moment on the plane right alongside the most highly qualified specialist in reconstructive surgery and embalming in the country, John Melvin Liggett, was starting to make a facsimile of the dead president, using the body of J.D. Tibbett, in order to obscure the true extent of the damage to Kennedy's head and make it seem consistent with a shot from behind. But Liggett realized immediately this was well nigh impossible, because having been told over the radio about the head shot, Liddy took it upon himself to try and ape this damage by firing into Tibbett's torso and then, when he was down, firing into his right temple, instead of into the back of the head as he'd been instructed. This was a second huge mistake. The human brain has a consistency like play school plasticine. Fire a bullet through it, and it is very easy for a skilled pathologist to track the bullet's path at autopsy. What Liggett wanted to show to any investigators was a brain that looked like this. What he had was one brain which looked like this, and another which looked like this. A large portion of Kennedy's brain had been ripped out by the impact of the explosive or frangible bullet, and what remained was filled with tiny shards of lead, some of them microscopic, which might take all night to locate. Liggett was terrified. The plotters had asked him to play Dr. Frankenstein at 30,000 feet. Yet with all his embalming experience, he instantly realized a botched job was the best he could possibly deliver. In his panic, he sawed off Tippett's skull and simply ripped out the entire brain to at least make sure no one could track the bullet, which, after Liddy's error, had so obviously come from the wrong direction. He then compounded Liddy's error by making a large hole in the rear of the head to ape the damage to Kennedy's head. With this done, he rebuilt the skull, hurriedly sewed the scalp back together, and then set about the gruesome task of trying to make the cadaver of J.D. Tibbett more closely resemble the cadaver of John F. Kennedy. By shaving eyebrows, bringing forward Tippett's slightly more receding hairline, filling in missing segments of both heads with plaster of Paris, and rebuilding portions of the flesh with wax. Liggett performed this ghoulish service while the aircraft he was on, Air Force 2, went through the usual procedure of leapfrogging Air Force 1 to arrive at Andrews Air Force Base slightly earlier. He wasn't given long enough, and in the rush to get finished, the plotters now made their third and most stupid mistake. Instead of placing Tippett's body in a casket identical to the one aboard Air Force 1, they placed him in a Spartan grey metal coffin inside a body bag. As the TV media showed these distressing pictures to a world reeling in shock, it's hardly surprising that no one ever dreamed this casket could be empty, but it was. As it was driven away, out of sight of the media, the two bodies were taken from Air Force 2 and loaded onto a helicopter. It was at this point that the two honest men, FBI agents Francis X. O'Neill and his partner William Siebert, became crucial figures in the story. They explained to researcher David Lifton that they made the journey to the Naval Hospital at Bethesda in the car behind the hearse which carried Jackie and Bobby, and most notably Admiral George Berkeley, who made sure he stayed with the empty coffin by sitting on another man's lap. Upon reaching Bethesda, Siebert and O'Neill said Berkeley then guided the family members into the building while the hearse was ordered to the rear to unload. But that was where the simplicity ended. The FBI men and many other witnesses recalled a scene of absolute mayhem in which no one seemed to know what was going on, and military men were rushing around everywhere, exchanging anecdotes about decoy ambulances they had been ordered to follow, which had become high-speed chases around the hospital grounds as these vehicles raced away. It seems this confusion was created with the intention of misleading both the press and the large respectful crowd which had gathered on the lawn. People were asking each other which ambulance contained the president's body. Then a rumour started that it was coming by helicopter, but which one? Everyone watching that night recalls the air was filled with them, and the FBI men also told Lifton that in the midst of all this mayhem, they helped to carry the casket inside. This was flatly denied by the team of Navy men who said they did it alone. It is therefore perfectly clear that two bodies were brought to the morgue separately whilst confusion reigned. And it was now that the plotters themselves became confused by the mayhem they had created, because they left J.D. Tibbett's cadaver in the wrong casket. It should have been switched and gone into the autopsy room in the large expensive casket used in Dallas.
I helped put President Kennedy's body in a bronze ceremonial casket on November 22nd, 1963, at Parker Memorial Hospital.
Instead, mortuary technician Paul O'Connor received a coffin so dull and nondescript, no one could believe it had been utilized to transport the body of a president.
It was a very plain casket, and when I say plain, I mean it was a pinkish gray. It had pink and gray on the sides. There was nothing fancy about it as far as being bronze. It wasn't bronze.
The autopsy then became a farce the moment it began. While Siebert and O'Neill made their now famous and entirely correct observation that the body seemed to have undergone surgery prior to autopsy, mainly in the head area, Commander Humes himself testified that the moment he touched the head, pieces of the skull fell down onto the autopsy table. That is not possible unless surgery was done before post-mortem. And that surgery could only have been performed aboard the aircraft because there was no other time to do it. Humes then found that he had to try to work with Admirals Berkeley, Galloway and Kenny actually touching his elbows, and became increasingly confused and embarrassed himself at his utter failure to find any trace of the bullets which killed the president. Of course, this was hardly surprising, considering the president lay dead in an adjoining room, and that Liggett had removed all the bullets from J.D. Tibbett. As the autopsy proceeded, O'Connor revealed that Berkeley interfered constantly in the procedure, steering Humes away from the torso, where he would have found the holes made by Liddy. And while everyone in the room remained aghast and disturbed by the huge hole in the back of the head and absence of any brain matter, two porters O'Connor had never seen before came in pushing a trolley, which had a sheet on it which hid a small lump. They had told people in the corridor it was a dead newborn baby, but it turned out to be a complete brain, which could only have come from a third cadaver. This was weighed and pickled in formaldehyde before anyone even had a chance to inquire when it had been removed. The most farcical moment of all came when Humes faced Arlen Specter in front of the Warren Commission and found the leading counsel pressing him to say that the wound he found in the back of the head was an entry wound. His incredible answer was that the bullet could only have entered and exited from the rear. Humes actually told the world that the bullet had done a U-turn inside the president's skull. Now that we know the truth, it may seem remarkable that David Lifton got so close, and yet never quite realized that what he had been investigating for 15 years was a body switch. But can we really be surprised? Like so many other decent men, Lifton was simply unable to imagine that anyone could ever think up such a grotesque and degenerate conspiracy. He simply never realized that what he was dealing with was nothing less than the devil himself. And for those who find all this impossible to accept, one of the devils who murdered JFK, Frank Sturgis, was perfectly candid about how routine body switches had become in the CIA by 1963.
There was a switch.
A body switch.
A body switch, yes.
The truth about the autopsy is that the devils who killed Kennedy messed up very badly. They had wanted to show the world actual photographs of a single bullet wound from behind. As it was, they had to resort to a lot of badly faked photographs, which critics like Robert Grodin easily discredited, and silly drawings, which everyone realized did not line up anywhere near the schoolbook depository. With the autopsy over, Mrs. Kennedy and the president's brother were shown the body prepared for burial. Not surprisingly, they were wholly unconvinced by Liggett's attempts to make a Dallas police officer look like the President of the United States. Witnesses there at the time said Bobby scoffed and said, "It doesn't look anything like him." While Mrs. Kennedy became adamant, "It isn't Jack," she declared. "That looks like something you'd find in Madame Tussaud's wax museum." Many people have studied this alleged picture of the president's remains and wondered how it could possibly be John F. Kennedy when the Zapruder film clearly shows this right temple area being blown apart by the impact of the frangible bullet. The simple answer is that this is not JFK. It's the corpse of Officer J.D. Tibbett, surgically altered to look like the president. On arriving home, Liggett was informed the plot was in serious trouble. His wife Lois told how he staggered in the door, unkempt, dishevelled, and quite obviously exhausted, which was very out of character for a man who took pride in always being neat, tidy, and organised.
"It was about 24 hours before I heard from him. He came home, and he walked in the door, and when I saw him, he physically looked like he had really been through a very traumatic experience. His clothes were disarrayed, and that was so out of character for him. And he said, 'We're going to get out of town for a while until all of this blows over.'" That was a quote, because I thought, well, what blows over?
Minutes later, they were speeding down the highway towards Corpus Christi, utterly bewildered as to what on earth was going on. Chain-smoking at the wheel, Liggett was looking increasingly nervous. It wasn't just that his botched reconstruction had failed to convince and would lead to courtroom testimony of bullets doing U-turns inside the president's head. The problem was that the Patsy was still alive. Deputy Sheriff Roger Craig told investigators it was plain to him that Lee Harvey Oswald was not meant to survive his arrest procedure. He said that when he arrived at the Texas Theater, a group of his fellow officers were waiting at the rear, guns drawn, and that it was quite obvious that Oswald was meant to make a break out the back door where he would run into a hail of gunfire. However, Oswald himself was an intelligence agent, and once he realized he had been chosen as the fall guy, he briefly prolonged his existence by loudly yelling so that all the witnesses present could hear, "I am not resisting arrest. I am not resisting arrest." This is why Liggett, like all the others involved in the plot, was shaking in his boots on November 23rd. They were all aware that a sharp lawyer could get Oswald released simply by discovering that the chain of evidence had been broken in relation to Kennedy's remains. Once free to talk, and with intimate knowledge of the major players in the assassination plot, he could have gotten the heads of the FBI and CIA, all the military chiefs of staff, the mafia chieftains, and the Dallas oil men all thrown in jail together for murder. Many people have wondered how the plotters could be so unbelievably dumb and so unbelievably obvious as to have Oswald murdered live on national television. The simple truth was that they had absolutely no choice. Their botched assassination attempt had proved that they were not as smart as they thought they were. The actual shooting had gone very badly. Most of the shots had missed. They'd had to botch the autopsy, and now they were having to botch the silencing of the Patsy. Lois Liggett recalled that the moment Ruby fired, the atmosphere in their motel room evaporated.
The minute he saw that, he looked at me and said, "Everything's okay now," and you could just see his face. He was like all the pressure had been taken off of him.
All of a sudden, he was like, sigh of relief, "Let's go. We can go home now." It was basically, "Pack your things. Come on, we're leaving. You know, now we can go."
The family turned around and went straight back home to discover that Mr. Liggett now enjoyed a new vocation. It appeared he had suddenly come into millions, which bought his family a big new house and himself a new lifestyle, which included many wild poker parties at which, among others, he hosted David Ferry. This was not Lois Liggett's scene. She divorced him, heard that not long afterwards he was arrested for murder, and then shot dead while trying to escape. But this was not the end of Liggett's story. His new wife told Lois that the man she buried could not have been John Melvin Liggett, because the corpse she was shown had a moustache and he couldn't grow one. Then many years later, Lois Liggett actually saw her deceased ex-husband in a casino while on a trip to Las Vegas. Quite clearly, this man had been the beneficiary of yet another CIA body switch. And to this day, doubts remain as to the true fate of Jack Ruby, Lee Oswald, John Liggett, and the president himself. Many researchers now believe the plotters may have kept Kennedy's remains as a souvenir and buried J.D. Tibbett in Arlington Cemetery.